In 1963, Stanley Milgram conducted what was to become one of the most controversial and influential studies in psychology. Appalled by historical events such as the Holocaust, in which large numbers of people were involved in the commission of atrocious acts in the name of following orders, Milgram wanted to find out, under controlled conditions, just how far the general public would go in adhering to the demands of an authority figure. This is the now infamous 1963 Milgram study. Milgram's study began with the participant being invited into the laboratory by an experimenter wearing a white lab coat. At this point, they were introduced to a second participant who was actually a confederate of the experimenter, but the real participant was unaware of this. The real participant was asked to draw a paper slip from a hat to determine their role in the experiment as either the teacher or the learner. Unbeknownst to the real participant, the draw was rigged. The hat only contained slips of paper featuring the word teacher, which ensured that the real participant would always be assigned the role of teacher, and the fake participant, i.e. the confederate of the experimenter, would always be assigned the role of the learner. The participants were told that the purpose of the study was to explore the role of punishment on learning.
All right, now let me explain to you, learner, exactly what's going to happen and what you're supposed to do. The teacher will read a list of word pairs to you like these. Blue girl, nice day, fat neck, and so forth. You are to try to remember each pair.
In this study, the punishment would take the form of electric shocks, which would be administered by the teacher.
Now, if you get it correct, fine. If you make an error, however, you'll be punished with an electric shock. So, of course, it is to your advantage that you learn all these word pairs as quickly as possible.
A shock generator located in front of the participants featured 30 labeled switches, running from 15 volts all the way to 450 volts in 15 volt increments. The voltage labels range from slight shock to XXX. Every time the teacher flicked a switch, the light above it would illuminate and they would hear a buzzing sound. Participants were then given a mild 45 volt shock to the wrist to convince them that the shocks were genuine. However, unbeknownst to the real participant, the shock generator was just an intimidating looking prop, and the shocks they would be instructed to give to the learner would be entirely fake. Of course, the learning task identified by the experimenter was also staged and rigged, such that the learner would consistently give wrong answers, that the participant would then have to punish with electric shocks. Before the study began, the learner, or confederate of the experimenter, was relocated to an adjacent room, connected to the shock generator by wires, but out of sight of the participant. During the study, the learner simply used a series of pre-scripted responses to create the impression they were receiving genuine shocks. These pre-scripted responses escalated from mild protests to screams of pain and then outright demands that the experiment be stopped.
Get me out of here, please.
Continue, please. Go right on.
Let me out.
Until eventually, at the 450 volt shock level, the learner just fell silent.
450 volts.
As if they'd lost consciousness. Or worse. When the participant hesitated or refused to deliver a shock, the experimenter would respond with one of four standardized prompts that escalated in firmness. Please continue. The experiment requires you to continue. It is absolutely essential that you continue. You have no other choice but to continue. The study would be terminated when the participants refused to comply, having been given the fourth prompt.
It's absolutely essential that you continue.
Well, he don't want to. I refuse to.
So he had no other choice. You must go.
Yes, I have a choice.
Or after they'd administered the 450 volt shock, three times.
Time!
All right, excuse me, teacher. We'll have to discontinue the experiment. I'd like to ask you a few questions, if I may.
What proportion of the participants in Milgram's study do you think would have administered the full range of shocks, right up to 450 volts, which on the shock generator was labeled as XXX? Would you believe that 65% of the participants flicked the switch to administer a 450 volt shock? All of the participants continued to the point of administering a 300 volt shock, which was labeled as an extreme intensity shock on the generator, and accompanied by the learner pounding their fists on the adjacent wall in protest. These were astonishing findings, even to Milgram and his colleagues, who reputedly, before the experiment began, had estimated that only between 1 and 3% of the participants would ever administer the full range of shocks. So why did the participants show such a high degree of obedience to the experimenter? For his part, Milgram argued that the presence of someone perceived as a legitimate authority figure tended to induce an agentic state in which participants felt much less responsible for their actions and could thus more easily be compelled into behaviour that they would otherwise view as completely unacceptable. Another explanation revolves around the fact that the shock levels in the experiment increased gradually, which meant that as the participant worked their way through the shocks on the generator, it became progressively more difficult for them to refuse to administer future shocks because doing so would be inconsistent with their earlier behaviour. Our predisposition to want to be seen to be consistent in our behaviour means that a pretty reliable way of getting someone to agree to a big request is getting them to agree to a series of smaller requests beforehand, and that's exactly how the Milgram study was set up. Some explanations have pointed to the extremely unusual situation that participants were placed in during the Milgram study, and suggested that under these very ambiguous conditions, it's only natural that participants would have looked to the experimenter for advice and guidance on how to behave appropriately. Some contemporary interpretations of the work of Milgram have pointed to the importance of the identification of participants with the scientific purpose of Milgram's study as being instrumental in the levels of obedience observed. They argue that people are more likely to follow harmful orders when they identify with and believe in the cause behind them. Participants were encouraged to identify with the scientific purpose of Milgram's study through a combination of an authoritative experimenter, the association of the study with the prestigious Yale University, and the importance placed on advancing scientific knowledge. Not surprisingly, Milgram's work has generated a lot of controversy, the focus of much of which concerns ethical issues with his research methodology, such as the use of deception and subjecting participants to significant levels of stress. Indeed, Milgram's research was the catalyst for the development of the ethics codes that govern research involving human participants within psychology to this very day. For example, a key feature of contemporary research ethics codes is that participants need to be made explicitly aware that they have the right to withdraw from a study at any point without the need to give an explanation and without any negative consequences for them. Arguably, the most important legacy of Milgram's work was the demonstration that evil deeds are not simply the preserve of evil people. Under the right, or perhaps I should say wrong, circumstances, most of us have the capacity for truly appalling behaviour in the name of adherence to authority. I'll leave the closing words to Stanley Milgram himself. It may be that we are puppets, puppets controlled by the strings of society, but at least we are puppets with perception, with awareness, and perhaps our awareness is the first step to our liberation. Be good to each other. See you in the next video.